I'm one of the people at the museum that was involved with the Sue project from the very beginning.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Sotheby's. We have for auction today the fossil of a Tyrannosaurus rex known as Sue.
My boss, John Flynn, asked that I accompany him to New York to look at the specimen and advise them whether we should, in fact, bid or not. Was this really the most complete T-Rex known? Was it well-preserved enough to be mounted? Could the process be done in time for us to open it as a millennial event during the year of 2000? We came to realize that everything that had been said about her was true. The reason Sue is so important because she's so complete. Not only is she the most complete T-Rex known, she's the biggest T-Rex known. And we think she may be the oldest T-Rex known.
Because of that, we have a better record of the anatomy and the biology of this animal than we have for any other T-Rex.
This is the specimen that really puts it all together. I often refer to Sue as the Rosetta Stone of Tyrannosaurus rex. I think none of us were quite used to the media circus that has always surrounded Sue. When that semi rolled into the Field Museum parking lot, there were a lot of reporters.
Tyrannosaurus just has this iconic place in everyone's mind, but I think it's also transcended into sort of that cultural realm. You look at what's the representation of a dinosaur? Well, it's T-Rex.
I think dinosaurs really capture a person's curiosity, you know, that people just wonder, how did this happen? How did this come to be?
We currently think that dinosaurs evolved about 230 million years ago or so, and they shared the rest of the Triassic with a number of other large related animals. But then about 200 million years ago, we hit an extinction boundary, and all these other things that dinosaurs coexisted with simply disappeared. They went extinct. And dinosaurs truly flourished, and they became the giants you know. And so at the end of the Jurassic, we have the famous animals we know, like Brachiosaurus, Apatosaurus, Allosaurus, Ceratosaurus. So these things lived about 145 million years ago. And then T-Rex is actually from the very end of the age of dinosaurs. So the last 2 to 3 million years there, from 68 to 65 million years ago, is when this animal reigned North America. Sue is from towards the end of that.
At the time of Sue, I was both managing the collections as collections manager and managing the labs as chief preparator, so I was in charge of the preparation phase of Sue. With the Sue project, we'd gotten the skeleton in October of 97, and it was going to open to the public May 17th, 2000. But people now had heard the buzz about Sue. They wanted to see her. So we designed two brand new preparation laboratories, one here at Field Museum and then one down in Orlando at the Dino Land part of Animal Kingdom in Disney World. Both of these new labs were what we call public labs, in that they had glass fronts to them so that the public could see what we were doing. We had a preparation staff of 12 people working very carefully. They didn't take shortcuts, but we had a deadline for the first time.
My job is to extract the fossils out of the matrix, which is rocks surrounding the fossils. To prepare fossils, you have to first expose the piece of bone. Once you see the bone, you have to follow that surface. In the case of Sue, T-Rex is a known skeleton, so people had a pretty decent idea of how to go through it.
We would use miniature jackhammers to take off 95% of the rock, leaving just a thin veneer of rock, or matrix as we call it, on the bone. And then the second step would remove this thin veneer of matrix using basically a miniature sandblaster. But instead of using sand as the abrasive, because that would be way too abrasive, we use basically baking soda, sodium bicarb, and then we were left with a really pristine, untouched bone surface. It took us about 30,000 hours to take all the rock off of Sue's skeleton. There's a lot of surface there. We moved a lot of rock, and we had to do it in a very controlled and careful fashion. You get one shot at it. If during the preparation process we destroy a part of the fossil, well, no amount of research is gonna fix that.
My job is to conserve the fossils so it would remain in the collection room for hundreds of years to come, not just for our generation, but next generation.
The initial scientific discoveries of dinosaur bones happened in the early 19th century in the United Kingdom. After those initial European discoveries, people realized that there was a bounty of fossils in the American West, and dinosaurs started pouring in. In 1902 was the initial discovery of Tyrannosaurus rex by the American Museum by Barnum Brown in Montana. Between 3 and 4 dozen T-Rex skeletons have been found now, and they continue to be discovered at a fairly rapid pace, but so far none has been anywhere near as complete as the animal you see behind me. One of the greatest challenges to studying an extinct organism is to try and infer something about the biology, the physiology, aspects of the animal that really aren't preserved. And so we have a number of ways we can get at that.
When we're studying these fossil bones, sometimes we'll cut off a thin section, like a cross section of a bone, and glue it onto a glass slide, and then we can put it under a microscope and actually see the cellular detail of a bone that's 67 million years old.
We've been able to cut some of Sue's bones and estimating growth rates from these annual markers in the bone. You can think of them as tree rings. We know it grew very fast. Like all dinosaurs, T-Rex would have hatched from an egg. It would probably have been less than 10 pounds at birth. And it would have grown fairly rapidly during its teenage years, perhaps as high as 4 to 5 pounds a day. And it would have reached its maximum size around 18 or 19 years of life, and then might have lived on for another 10 years.
We have discovered through studying Sue that she was 28 when she died. And we can tell from her skeleton that she led a tough life. Her left fibula, the bone next to the shin bone, is grotesquely enlarged compared to the right one. So it had some sort of infection. Also, the triceps muscle was pulled completely off the bone, and the bone was sort of reaching out to reheal and reattach to the end of the triceps muscle. Three ribs right next to the shoulder blade are broken, and we can see the big healed knuckles where extra bone was added. When you break a bone and it heals bigger than it was originally.
This is an animal that lived long enough to really build up a serious record of trauma, but none of those injuries were immediately related to the death of this animal. We did have some brain casts of T-Rex before, but they were basically made by sawing down the middle of the skull and then taking a cast. That would be a terrible thing to do to a unique specimen like Sue, but now we have the technology to look in there. One of the ones that we rely on most is CAT scanning or CT scanning. Basically, we use X-rays to generate three-dimensional models of structures like the brain cavity.
We know her digitally and can manipulate these digital models in ways that help inform us what shape the brain is, how big it is, and you know what the different shapes in the brain tell us about what Sue would have been like.
So we know that T-Rex had a pretty good sense of vision, a remarkably good sense of smell, a good sense of balance, which is what you'd expect for an animal that's a biped and fairly rapid. Another exciting thing we've done with Sue is we've actually scanned this skeleton as well as all of the individual bones so that we can make digital models of the entire skeleton, and we can answer questions like exactly how big was Sue, how much did she weigh. We use engineering techniques that are used to design car bodies to put outlines on the body, body contours if you will, informed of course by how flesh relates to bone in living animals, and come up with a range of reasonable models for T-Rex, and we came up with an estimated body weight of probably around 9 tons as a reasonable estimate, which is 2 tons more than we had before. One of the fascinating things about T-Rex is, of course, that it's one of the largest bipedal animals to ever walk. To me, the coolest thing about Sue is understanding how far nature can go and what its limits are.
So how could an animal this large, how would they move? A lot of people have the scene in Jurassic Park where T-Rex is running down a Jeep in mind. Was that possible? We now know that she weighed 9 to 10 tons. That makes it less likely that she would have run very often or at all. But she had very long legs, long strides, so even at a fast walk, she would have been moving quite fast and easily fast enough to walk down her prey.
This animal had the biggest leg muscles of anything that ever lived, but they weren't there to make it a fast predator. They're actually required to stabilize this giant body. So it's a cantilevered system where the tail sort of counterbalances the head and the front end. And you just need these massive thigh and hip muscles to basically stabilize it.
Once we started finishing some of the bones of Sue, we then sent them to New Jersey, where Phil Fraley and his group were set to begin the mounting. The mounting is the creation of this metal framework that will hold the bones in a lifelike pose so that people can look at the skeleton and imagine what it might have been like in life. There are a number of T-Rex skeletons known, and so for the most part, we knew where the bones would go. There are these bones that hang down from the backbones and the tail. They're called chevrons. And I remember the first time they had the tail up and mounted, I noticed that they'd gotten the chevrons one position off. That was probably a subtlety that not many people would even care about had they even known. But it was important that we get it right because there is some issue about the chevrons being involved with maybe being able to tell what gender the animal is.
The animal's called Sue after its discoverer, but we don't actually know if this was a male or female. Some initial attempts were made to look at some of the bones in the tail, right behind the hips.
Reptiles, dinosaurs, if they're laying an egg, they may need more space between the hips and the chevrons, which are hanging down from the tail. And so, you want to make sure that you put the chevrons in the right place because you might be able to use that data to answer that question. Was this an egg-laying female or was it a male? One of the questions that the mounting group needed from us was, how did we want the skeleton posed?
The body posture of T-Rex, the famous kangaroo posture, which was favored by museums in the past because it brought the head another 6 or 7 feet up in the air, was incorrect. And the tail goes kind of straight down and then it's broken and kinked along the ground, and no animal does that.
The American Museum had remounted their T-Rex so that the body was horizontal and the legs were fairly vertical. We wanted to do it a little bit differently. So while the body is still held horizontal, Sue is crouching a little bit. You could stand in front of Sue and imagine what it might be like if you'd caught the attention of a T-Rex. This is the real skull of Sue. It's not on the end of the neck because it would be too hard to study 13 feet up in the air. And we can see that there are some differences between this and the cast that we did put on the mount. The skull is a very large object, and after 67 million years being buried in hard rock, deep under the earth, it's been distorted over time. You can see that the skull doesn't look like the sort of straightened out version that we made to put on the end of the neck. This is the business end of one of the largest predators known in the history of the Earth. And the teeth are the primary weapon. Unlike some of the other large carnivorous dinosaurs, the teeth are banana-shaped. They're thicker. They're more robust. So this is an animal that could chew through not only flesh, but bone as well. The longest tooth in Sue is about 12 inches long. And you can see where the enamel is. It's about one-third of the length of the tooth. The enamel part of the tooth shows you what was exposed, what Sue was actually using. The rest of the tooth that didn't need the enamel is anchored in solid bone, and this gives you some idea of the bite forces involved. You can also see the large orbit where the eyeball would be housed. These orbits face forward, and so you get an overlapping visual field that gives Sue very effective three-dimensional vision. This has obvious advantages to a predator. And in fact, there was one study that estimated Sue could see at 7 miles what we can see at 1 mile. Researchers from all over the world have come to study Sue's skull and jaws. That's why it's in this case rather than on the end of the neck. But it's also gratifying to see the look on the faces of our public when they can get within a couple of feet of this ferocious carnivore.
There are a number of questions that we have yet to answer regarding Sue. One is, of course, how this animal met its demise. There was an idea put forth shortly after Sue was discovered that it was killed by another T-Rex, and the evidence to support that was supposed to be these holes in the lower jaw. The problem with the holes in the lower jaw is they don't occur in any pattern that's consistent with the tooth row of a T-Rex, and they all show some degree of healing. These are probably caused by some kind of pathogen. It could be fungal, it could be a parasite, it could be bacterial. And we have similar features we see in living birds that ultimately can cause their death.
There was a lot of debate about where to put Sue when she arrived at the museum. She could have been put in our Great Hall of Dinosaurs to give a temporal context to when she lived. But I've looked at Sue with artists, and they're always interested in her as a sculptural object. It's just so beautiful. We decided she's kind of like the David of Michelangelo. She really deserves pride of place, and that's why we put her in Stanley Field Hall, the great main hall of the museum.
Sue was unveiled live on morning TV. Sue was hidden from view by a double curtain. Mayor Daley was there. We'd brought in a bunch of school kids, and it was all lit up with blue and white lights. And finally, the curtain dropped, and there was a thrill from the crowd. Everyone sort of, wow, there it is.
There have been a few years at the Field Museum where attendance has gone over 2 million people a year. The World's Fair in 1933 in Chicago, exhibitions about King Tut of Egypt, and the debut of Sue in 2000. 21 million people have seen Sue since she debuted here. She's our icon.
We've also traveled Sue around the world. We have two traveling casts that have gone to half a dozen countries, have been seen by 7 million people. So I think as a teaching and outreach icon, Sue is probably unparalleled in the world of paleontology.
I know that Sue is going to play a vital role in research into the species Tyrannosaurus rex, as well as our understanding of the Cretaceous era. So we're glad she's in a public museum where many people and many scholars also can see her. There's just a lot more to discover about Sue.